For going through the agenda for today, I would like to start my topic by giving you a brief introduction to the concept of API Marketplace, talk a bit about why it is special in an integrated API supply chain to have this marketplace in place. I would also touch upon different patterns available in API marketplaces in how organizations use this API marketplace. I will talk a bit about some of the building blocks required to build a marketplace and walk you through how WS2 platform can be used to build this API marketplace that you require. And I will finally talk about some of the key concepts in terms of building a network of developers to come and use your marketplace and other aspects like such as socialization, how you market your APIs and things like that. And finally, summarize the discussion that summarize the points that I spoke to you during the talk so that you can have some takeaways to go and introduce to your organization. Okay, so let's talk about the concept of a marketplace. Most of you are familiar with the concept of a marketplace. It's basically a location where people gather to buy and sell goods. It can be a farmer's market, it can be your vegetable market, fish market, or whatever the market that you're familiar with. The commonality is that there is a buyer and a seller who comes together to do a transaction. So if I explain the concept with this photograph, so you would have a host where the host can be a location, a building, a premises that hosts the event. There are multiple providers who come and set up shop selling different types of items, and there are multiple consumers who walks around, sees what is available, sample some of the items, and then buy whatever they want. So that's the overall concept of a marketplace. And if you move to the API space, the API marketplace is something similar. So it is a marketplace where it's basically a meeting place for API providers who provides or who creates APIs, and then API consumers who come looking to find the right API to integrate in their application. These API consumers would come and search for APIs. They go through reviews, try out the API, try a sample of an API, and then if they're happy, they will subscribe or pay for that API and use that API within the application. So the journey is very much similar to your traditional marketplace, but the main difference is now it's a digital marketplace rather than a physical marketplace. Okay, so let's talk about some of the differences of the API marketplace from a traditional marketplace. So an API marketplace is virtual, so it's a digital marketplace. However, as I explained earlier, the experience of buying and selling is very much similar. So you have multiple buyers coming in, looking for products, talking with, interacting with providers through chat or through a forum, sampling items, trying out items. So all that options are available in API marketplace, but in a virtual manner. Secondly, there's no physical boundaries. So this is the biggest difference. If you have a physical marketplace, the access is limited to people who lives in that geography. But with an online marketplace or API marketplace, your boundaries are virtual. So it's essentially boundaryless. You have anyone who has access to that or who has access to internet has access to your marketplace if it is a public marketplace. So essentially, there's no physical boundaries. The third difference is that the commodity that is sold or shared is an API. And API is not the end commodity. So if you go to a traditional marketplace, you might come and buy certain vegetables, which is the end product that you buy. But when it comes to an API, you buy or you subscribe to an API, but you are not the ultimate consumer of the API. You will use that API to embed it within your application so that some of your customers will be the final consumer of the product. So it's basically a means to a larger journey rather than you being the final consumer of the product that is sold in the marketplace. And finally, API marketplace is technology driven. It's a digital product available as a through a digital delivery medium, and this marketplace is a purely a technology play, and that allows that kind of takes away any competitive advantage that you have or a traditional API marketplace has. So if you take a traditional marketplace, if the marketplace is located in a prominent location, you have a competitive advantage. But it may not be the case in a digital marketplace or API marketplace where anyone has access to your marketplace and there's no prominent location per se. And you need to make sure that you have the right you need to have the right advertising method, right scale to have the required competitive advantage when compared to your competitors who sell a similar marketplace product. Okay, so let's look at the Rapid API marketplace. I'm sure most of you are familiar with this marketplace. So Rapid Market API marketplace is a common or a very famous marketplace out there. There are about 300,000 since 2020, they have had about 300,000 new developers to the Rapid API marketplace. Currently, it has 20,000 APIs hosted in the Rapid API marketplace. About 18,000 new organizations have signed up since they have opened up the organization program within the marketplace. Since 2020, they have sold about 30,000 new paid subscriptions on the marketplace. And with the COVID-19 pandemic situation, this marketplace has gained a lot of traction, and five of the most common COVID response APIs have in total got about 225 million calls during these 6 to 7 months to the Rapid API marketplace. And in total, they have delivered, or they have received over a trillion API calls to the API marketplace, and it's gaining traction every year, and more developers are coming. So what we can take out of these statistics is that primarily there is what actually reinforces the value of API marketplace is that there's a lot of volumes of APIs exposed and invoked. You would have legacy integrations. You might feel that some of the organizations that have legacy endpoints or legacy backends might be not in demand, but there's a lot of organizations who exposes their legacy capabilities as assets that can be consumed by different consumers. The volume, the sheer volume of APIs exposed by platforms like Rapid API shows that there's a lot of the lot of traction towards reusability. So organizations always prefer to use what's already available rather than trying to build something on their own. A good example would be if you take a travel organization or a tour operator who's building their own tour app, would want to have some weather services available within the app. So rather than the tour operator trying to scrape weather information from the local weather station, what they would do is they would connect to a weather API available and have that information available through the app. So that kind of allows them to reuse what's already available rather than allocating their resources in building that capability in-house. So these volumes also talks about how APIs are becoming the most common building block in modern organizations. So as I explained earlier, organizations would want to reuse what's already available rather than trying to build something new by themselves. And it's definitely becoming the new product in the 21st century. When you have with large amount of APIs exposed, you would have also multiple types of different organizations that come on board, both from a provider standpoint as well as a consumer standpoint. Providers who provide, say, if I take the same weather API example, they might find that their standard weather API is in demand. So they try to come up with different types of other useful APIs like wind APIs or humidity APIs that can be used by more organizations. So it's as my colleague Vidra was talking earlier, it's the network effect that comes in. When you have more organizations publishing APIs, you would have more consumers seeing the value and coming on board the platform. That in turn triggers more and more organizations to come in and provide the APIs through this marketplace. And finally, there's a lot of paid subscriptions. So it's not free for all kind of model. People see value in these APIs, and people are organizations are willing to pay to get that value out as well. So it's not really free APIs. And that encourages innovation. When you have paid subscriptions, it encourages providers to innovate and provide new APIs, new capabilities, improve whatever they have already, and it kind of fuels innovation, and at the same time encourages people to buy and then increase the revenue that you get out of the APIs that you expose. Okay, so I'll quickly talk about some of the API marketplaces patterns that are commonly available. Some of these patterns are from our experience with our existing customers. I'll basically go through five different types of patterns that are available. So I'll start with the first pattern, which is an internal marketplace. This internal marketplace has two variants. So the first variant is that it's a shared infrastructure. Each team department produces its own API, but they publish that API to a shared infrastructure. So you might have your finance department, your procurement department, all having their own APIs, but they publish to a shared infrastructure that is shared across the organization. So this kind of make sure that all organization APIs adhere to a same standard or a format that is used across the organization. From a product that delivers this capability, or from API management standpoint, you need to have the capability to control the visibility, so that what you publish you should be able to control. For example, a finance department publish an API. That API should only be visible to certain groups in the, or certain only to the employees in the finance department. Certain APIs, while certain APIs can be public to the entire organization. So the product that you choose should have the capability to control the visibility according to the need of that particular department or the business unit who's publishing the API. The second variant of the internal marketplace is distributed infrastructure setup, where you still have individual departments owning their own APIs, publishing their own APIs, but in this case they publish to a they have their own infrastructure where they have their own portal, they have their own publisher and gateway and so on, but they also want to maintain a shared central marketplace. So the same example as earlier, finance department may have its own API, but they also want to publish some of the APIs to the entire organization, to a central marketplace, so that other departments or business units can also consume that API. So this is this calls, from a product standpoint, this calls for the ability to publish APIs to multiple locations. So you have to have that option where you can publish to a local gateway and a local portal, as well as a public or a shared gateway and a shared portal as well. So that's the first pattern. The second pattern is a partner marketplace. A partner marketplace is where you would have the marketplace is open to your organization as well as to your partners. A good example of this is in an automobile industry. You might have a car manufacturer or automobile manufacturer having its own marketplace. But it also opens up its marketplace to its partners, who can be the dealerships, who can be your suppliers, so that they also can access your APIs within the organization. This kind of pattern calls for ability to integrate with external identities and the ability to bring your own identity. So, for example, a car dealership an employee on the, of the car dealership should be able to bring his own identity or use his own identity to access the API marketplace use those APIs. So that kind of identity infrastructure should be in place to support this kind of a pattern. Okay, so pattern three is a closed group marketplace. So the purview from the previous pattern increases. The previous pattern was only targeted to partners, but a closed group marketplace is where related companies in the same industry comes together and have a common marketplace. An example, if I take the same example of automobile manufacturer, you may have all automobile manufacturers coming together to publish API to a common marketplace that is available to all type of suppliers who supply products to the automobile industry. An example would be that tire manufacturer would have a common API that gives the specification of tires that can be available to all types of automobile manufacturers available. So those kind of marketplaces is basically open to multiple organizations. And the difference or what is required from API manager product in this case is the ability to standardize or have a standard template so that different organizations that use this marketplace to publish the APIs will follow the same standard when publishing an API. So from a consumer standpoint, whether you subscribe to an API from organization one or two or three, the standard, the format, the documentation is similar. So the experience in using that API is more or less similar across whether you use an API from a organization one or two or three, the experience is more or less similar from a consumer standpoint. The fourth pattern is a shared revenue marketplace. In this case, it's again an open group, available. I mean, the APIs are available to an open group, but in this case, there is a revenue sharing available. So the Rapid API marketplace is a good example of a shared revenue marketplace where anyone can come in and publish the APIs. Anyone can come and subscribe to the API, but there is a revenue sharing involved to encourage people to add value and create APIs in the marketplace. So this kind of a pattern calls for extensive identity federation. So you should be able to federate identities to social logins like Facebook, Google, and so on to encourage participation. And at the same time, you have to have a good monetization in place so that you have the ability to monetize the API and share revenue with the partners who provide the APIs in the platform. The fifth pattern is an aggregator marketplace. So it's a bit of an advanced pattern from the fourth pattern or the fifth pattern we spoke about earlier. In this case, you have the ability to collect and combine multiple APIs, aggregate them and provide an API product. So for example, you might have, take the example of Rapid API marketplace. There might be multiple weather APIs, there might be a Google API for location. So as a API aggregator, I should be able to come in, take the weather API from the weather application or existing weather API that is available, take an existing location API that is available and have and create a new API basically, where if I enter my geolocation, it will give me the weather information. So I can create an application that takes my current position and then provide the weather information to that current, with the weather information of that current position. So that kind of API or that kind of a marketplace requires the ability to provide or support API product. Yeah, you have the ability to mix and match multiple capabilities available from multiple APIs and then build a new product that can be exposed and sold in the marketplace. So those are the five common patterns that are available. And if you put those five patterns in a continuum in terms of how much they are open. So the first pattern we talk about, or the internal marketplace pattern, is more of a closed pattern. The partner marketplace becomes a bit more open from the pattern one, and closed group marketplace is a hybrid. Basically, it's open to a closed community, but it's not dedicated or restricted to a single organization. And shared revenue as well as aggregator marketplaces are more open patterns, and public, in most cases, are publicly available and can be accessed publicly. Okay, so let's talk about what should the platform provide for you to have this API marketplace or marketplaces in place. Most people or most organizations think that API marketplace is about having a developer portal, but it's not really the case. Developer portal is one aspect to the API marketplace, but it's more of having a complete ecosystem of components that supports the concept of API marketplaces. Let me explain it in a bit more detail. So if you take the journey, you need to have a process where someone can come in. Someone who owns or who has access to an asset internally should be able to come in, create an API. Either they create it using a Swagger or manually create that API and save it in the platform. So this particular person's role is about creating the API. And then there can be another user or what we call API or a product owner who will come in and set the business information related to the API. For example, the subscription policies, the throttling policies required for the API. Save the API, and they should be able to publish the API to an API gateway. So these two roles can be performed by the same person, but if it is a large organization which has a mature API marketplace, these can be two separate roles that is part of the API publishing process. So once the API is published, the API is available in the developer portal. Anyone who's interested can sign into the developer portal. They can sign in or sign up if they don't have an account. And then they can discover what are the APIs available. So if I am a person who's looking for a Veda API, I can see all the type of different Veda APIs available in the portal. I can create a subscription, probably a trial subscription if it's a paid API, and I can try out the API. See what's the request that it requires, what is the response that I get. I can even generate an SDK and see whether the code can be easily integrated with my application that I already have. And then finally, if I'm happy to use that application or the API, I can subscribe to that API. And even I have the option of providing feedback for improvements, ask questions and so on from the developer portal itself. So from a requirement standpoint, the publisher should support multiple capabilities. It has to have the ability to create an API. It can be from scratch or from an already existing Swagger document. You should have the ability to add new documents. You might have like how to guide. You should be able to add a Swagger document. You can edit your existing Swagger. All that should be capable from the API publisher standpoint. You should be able to have the ability to create API products out of the API. For example, as I explained earlier, you should be able to mix and match different resources and create your API product. You should also have the ability to control the reach. You should be able to control the visibility of an API to a given user role, a tenant, and so on, so that you can control who can have access or who can see the API. You have to have the ability to define policies such as rate limiting and security policies for your API. And finally, have the ability to manage the lifecycle of the API so that you can have the ability to move the API across different life cycles, version them as required during that particular process. So as a developer, you have the ability to, the platform should provide the ability to allow sign up. You should be able to self sign up. It can be pure self sign up, or you can even integrate it with a workflow. So when you sign up, you are not onboarded immediately. Someone approves your sign up, or someone approves your registration, and then only you are able to sign up to access the particular portal. There's also the need to integrate with existing identity and access management solutions. That can be whatever the solution that you have internally already, or to integrate with external identity and access management solutions, or federated identity servers or identity providers like Facebook or Google, so that users can bring their own identity when logging to the API portal. API should be easily discoverable. You have to have the ability to view what are the APIs available, what are the API products available, categorize them, tag them, search them, and so on. You should be able to see comments, ratings, reviews provided on API. You should be able to ask questions through a forum. And then finally, view documentation related to the API and see how easy it is to integrate this particular API within your application. From a developer portal standpoint, you should have the ability to manage your subscription. So you should be able to allow creating applications and subscribing APIs to that particular application. You should be able to generate keys and manage keys from the developer portal. You should be able to try out APIs using the Swagger-based testing tool that we provide, or the product provide in this, in the API managers, in WS2 API managers case, we have an inbuilt Swagger tool to do the same. We should have the ability to get the SDK for fast integration. So you should be able to see what are the SDKs that are supported, download the SDK of your preferred application and integrate with your application. And finally, you should be have the ability to work with the community. Share your application that you create, provide feedback to your API and so on within the from the developer portal itself. From a security standpoint, you should have the option to do identity federation, which includes bringing your own identity, SSO across multiple portals that are available. The platform should provide multiple options when providing API security, such as standard auth, basic auth, certificate-based authentication, and so on. There should be ability to fine-grained access control as well, if required. Some APIs might be sensitive in nature, so you need to make sure that you protect them against, do certain threat protection. You should also have the ability to do API audits, security audits on the API to see whether they are actually secured before you publish them in a public portal. And if you look at the governance is an important aspect. So the product or the platform should have the ability to support full lifecycle API management. So you should be able to control the lifecycle. You should be able to version the APIs as and when required. And you should be able to control things like the subscription as well as sign up process, so that it goes through an approval process if required, to ensure that you vet who creates an API, who signs up to the portal, so that you have some control in who uses your APIs and who publishes APIs to your portal. When it comes to analytics, data becomes very important when it's a public API marketplace. You should provide statistics for API providers in terms of who's using your APIs, what are your top APIs, how many subscriptions are there for your API, what regions this traffic originates from, and what are the latency of your API, so that your API providers can improve their existing APIs and offer new capabilities if required. For API consumers, you should tell them how many end users are using the APIs that they subscribe to. So they have some statistics in terms to see how many users come or actually consume that API through the applications that you create. That should be part of the analytics provided. And then there should be alerts, both real-time notifications in terms of the service outages, throttling outs, and so on, so that you understand and you have the ability to provide a better offering and improve your existing offering to make sure that they are in line with the SLAs that you want to provide from your API marketplace. When it comes to monetization, you should provide support to do to monetize your APIs. You should have the ability to provide billing capabilities, both commercial and freemium plans, and have the option of anyone who wants to expose the APIs freely to be able to do that as well. You should have the capability to link billing plans to APIs and integrate with existing billing engines like Stripe or other billing engines that are widely used in the industry, so that the billing process can be more open and flexible when it comes to charging your end users as well as your API consumers. Okay, so finally, I'll talk about what you need when building your own API marketplace. So WS2 offers multiple components to build your API marketplace. There is a developer portal available. So I'll start with the developer portal. This is where this is the component that is accessed by your application developers who comes and search for API and subscribe to APIs. The API creation process starts with the publisher. API developers would come and publish the APIs. Those APIs will get published to an API gateway or a micro gateway. The gateway connects to a key management component that does authentication and authorization. It also connects to a traffic manager that does traffic that controls throttling and rate limiting of your APIs. Gateway publishes statistics to a real-time analytics engine for real-time analytics, as well as it publishes statistics to a batch analytics engine that generates dashboards and other analytics required by the platform. When building an ecosystem, it is important to have the ecosystem should have security provision, the gateway capability to expose the APIs out. You should have the ability to secure what you expose from the API gateway. And then there is a marketplace requires activity management. For example, if you want to do workflow management, you should have that ability to control who accesses your who subscribes to your APIs and so on. You should have the ability to have a workflow to control those access. And then finally, you should be able to monitor and analyze and learn from the usage of your APIs to improve your existing offering, to have more capabilities, more offerings coming in, and then being able to offer them through the API platform. It is important to make the marketplace interactive. You should promote reusability through incentivizing the usage. You should be able to monetize or provide monetary incentives to your API publishers. You should be able to, you should also have things like developer hall of fame, public mentions to encourage people to come and publish APIs to the platform. Again, and then growth and revenue sharing is also important in this kind of a marketplace available. Organizations should also do active evangelism, do workshops, hackathons to encourage API marketplace, encourage use of the API marketplace, and then have a clear communication model in terms of how you communicate new capabilities to different consumers, so that they are aware of what are the new features available, what are the new APIs available, and so on. This can be through a newsletter or an e-bulletin that you send monthly to different subscribers. So, in summing up what I've spoken so far, key takeaways are the API marketplace is a mandatory value addition when building an integrated API supply chain. Components matter. You have to select the right component. You have to select the right platform that offers all the bits and pieces that you require to build the API marketplace. You need to pick which pattern that suits your organization, whether it's a closed pattern or open pattern. It all depends on what your organizations require. And you just don't stop at API marketplace. You also have to build the surrounding ecosystem that encourages promoting, encourages publishing more APIs, encouraging people to come in and use the platform more interactively at the end of the day.